Hello, I'm Craig DeRouch. As Christians, we're called to faithfulness every day in every area of our lives, including our role as citizens. But how can we live out our faith in a community that's increasingly polarized, our entire society? How can we make an impact in our current and future elections? Josh Hershberger, Director of Church Ambassador Network and General Counsel for Indiana Family Institute, one of our 40 state organizations, Indiana Family Institute, reviews biblical principles and the example of Christian citizens in the past and present. Josh reveals a four-step plan for gospel-centered citizenship. Folks, talk about needing that right now in a divided America, based on his book, The Good Citizen. I recommend that you guys all check this out, a four-step plan for gospel-centered citizenship in a divided America. Josh explains that America's future depends on prayer and engagement, including tough work on issues like parents' rights. Folks, it's not fun to go to a school meeting and call the bigot, but that's part of parenting. And he lives in Hanover, Indiana, not Hanover, Germany, thank goodness, with his wife and children, where he serves in church leadership and pastoral commitments as well as his legal work. I'm very excited to have you with us today, Josh. Thanks for being on the show.
No, it's great to be here, Craig. I appreciate all that you're doing around the country and your own personal example of living out the gospel and every day, everywhere.
Well, I can't do that unless I have, because I'm not a lawyer. I just got to be involved with the laws when I was a legislature. But folks, one of the primary things that what's going on in our culture that has saved our culture has been the courts, has been the legal action. People like Josh Hershberger, it's licensed in Tennessee, Kentucky, and he's licensed in a lot of federal courts that are staving this off. But I'd prefer if we dive into the policy. We don't get our relief from judges and injunctions. You talked this summer at our SoCon comment that parents are under attack on almost a daily basis. This is not isolated to blue states or you know, California or New York. This is becoming everywhere. And why Christians and the Family Policy Council's involvement is so important in parents' rights today.
Yeah, so I want to go back to scripture, and I think Christians clearly believe, they have long practiced this belief that parents have the right, they have the responsibility, according to scripture, to raise their children according to biblical principles, according to the nurture and admonition of the Lord, as the scriptures tell us. And then we know from the U.S. Supreme Court that parental rights, the right to raise your child according to beliefs, is perhaps the oldest fundamental liberty interest, is how the Supreme Court stated that, meaning that what good is freedom of speech? What good is even the right to free exercise of religion if you don't have the right to raise your kids according to that? And unfortunately, I'm here to say today that parental rights right now are under attack. They're under attack right now. And so let me give you kind of three quick examples of this. The first one is the right of parents in the public education system to know at times about what's going on at school. And so there's a current case. I actually am serving as co-counsel. Now, this case is in active litigation, so I'm just going to read a public statement, co-counsel along with Alliance Defending Freedom. So here's that statement. The South Madison Community School Corporation in Indiana fired school counselor Kathy McCord, a 37-year veteran in the education field, for speaking about the school district's gender identity policy. In August of 2021, the school district adopted a policy that required counselors and other employees to use names and pronouns for students that do not correspond with their sex, and get this, without requiring parental notification or consent. And in some cases, it even required employees to hide these new names and pronouns from parents. And so we know that parents are a critical part of a kid's life. Why would we keep that from them? Another way that this is iterating is if you think of a divorce situation where the two parents unfortunately are splitting up, ending their marriage. And as a part of that process, a judge may be called upon to make a decision. What's in the best interest of the child? Which parent should have primary physical custody? And what we're seeing in cases in different parts of the country is that these trial courts are using the fact that a parent either uses a preferred name or pronoun, or in a sense affirms a child's gender identity or not, as a factor and whether a child should be placed full-time with a parent. There's a particular parent, Ted Hudako, in California, where the court even allowed, a transgender surgery to be performed on a minor without his consent. And so,
Josh,
right there in the custody issue. Yeah.
I want to stop you there, because
Sure.
In a good way. You're really on to something in our audience. This is why we have really, and I'm so thankful, the Family Policy Alliance, we have access to brilliant lawyers like Josh, who makes it so clear so I can understand what we're talking about here. You're a lawyer. You don't practice family law like in the, what do they call that, friend of court, you know, where people get divorced, the civil courts, right? A lot, but you work on the policy for the folks that practice law a lot in those spaces. And what Josh has said is they're factoring in a parent's decision of whether or not they affirm the child's pronoun use. And understand, Josh, I'm so glad you brought that up, because for hundreds of years, those local courts, they're usually in a county where you live, or if you're a big enough city, they'd be in a city where you live, where you go and you get service if the parents are raising the children separately.
That's right.
And they normally would say, if a parent is providing alcohol to a kid under 21, mm-hmm. we will factor that and we'll take the kid away from you. If you're going to get them tattoos on their face, if you're going to give them other risky things, you know, you're drinking and driving, we're going to factor those in. But now they're actually factoring in the harmful thing for the kid as a positive thing. That's what you're saying, right?
That's correct. And when I started my practice, I tell folks I hung a shingle. I didn't have shingles. It's an old kind of English term for, you know, just starting a general law practice in a small town. And so I did practice family law for a time. And here's the thing. If a child said, I want to stay out until 2 a.m. on Saturday morning, the court's, of course, going to say, no, you can't do that. That would be bad parenting. But if a child says, I am a gender different than my biological sex, and that parent doesn't want to go along with it, and says, according to my beliefs, I think you're going to flourish if you embrace God, who God made you to be. And I'm going to raise you consistent with your biological sex. That, especially in Mr. Hudako's case, that was used against him. And now we're seeing that concern in a lot of other states around the country. And so you're right. That is a local, generally county court, or the different formats. But that, I mean, that hits exactly in the home, one of these God-ordained institutions. So it's a grave concern.
Yeah. And the next question I have for you is similar, and it's dark, folks. And unfortunately, these things that I'm going to talk about next to them get revealed for 20 or 30 years until they get to scale. And the LGBTQ effort to redefine child abuse could have a major impact on the areas, Christians, foster care, adoption, parental rights, education, and ministry itself, what you can say in a pulpit on Sunday. This is because of the LGBTQ, people that do not promulgate children together and raise them together, but consider children as an accoutrement to their life's, you know, lifestyle or what they've chosen, which to me, and it's not for our entire audience, I think is a selfish decision. I think the selfless decision is to try to co-parent and raise a child together, regardless of your situation, if you've created that child together. But you're here for different reasons. You're going to inform our audience about the major impact of the redefinition of the unintended consequences. This is not, folks, just about a lifestyle choice of the parents. This gets really bad really quick. Josh, could you tell us about some of our concerns with redefining child abuse?
Sure. And sometimes Christians ask me, you know, why are you speaking so much about some of these, you know, quote unquote, controversial issues, tough issues? But I really do think what's happened is the sexual revolution has moved from kind of an acceptance phase where, hey, it, you know, just go along and it's okay. And we're just part of society too. So from an acceptance phase, what I might call an enforcement phase. And no, as I've talked about Kathy McCord, as I've talked about this parent, and now for my own clients, Jeremy and Mary Cox, they're not out there trying to put their beliefs on someone or cause an issue. They're just simply trying to live out their faith. And so a case is very close to my heart. I represented Mary and Jeremy Cox. They publicized their name for over 2 years. They were just attempting to raise their family, doing a great job of that. And their son came to them, declared himself to be transgender. They believed, as we've talked about, that raising him consistent with his biological sex was best based on their belief, but also their research. And unfortunately, the state of Indiana, and note that, not California, not New York, state of Indiana, claimed that that was neglect or abuse, pulled him out of their home, barred them from speaking about the entire topic of gender to their own child in their own home, while placing him in a home that would affirm his gender identity using those names and pronouns. Now, after 5 months, the state dismissed all allegations of neglect and abuse against Mary and Jeremy. And then to our great surprise, despite that, they said, look, Mary and Jeremy, you've done nothing wrong. And yet, despite that, they kept him out of their home. He was actually out of their home for more than 2 years. It was never returned, eventually aging out of the foster care system here in Indiana. And so we appealed that case all the way to the United States Supreme Court. The court did order the state to respond, but ultimately didn't take it. We believe probably because this is a fairly novel situation. But this is not just one situation. In fact, the facts that I just recounted have now been codified in a state like Minnesota, Washington, and California. And some of our listeners, your listeners may be familiar with, we're going to call it the transgender kidnapping. But if a parent were to take a child, or a family friend might take a child from Indiana or from another state, if those parents are raising that kid consistent to their beliefs, they might take that kid to Minnesota. And Minnesota says, well, if you're not providing quote-unquote gender-affirming care, we're going to take custody of your child. I mean, this, I hope the listeners see, like, for me, this is a developing crisis. This is completely insidious, taking kids out of Christian homes. It's something that I think we all need to be aware of, and we need to push back in our states.
And on its face, it's nothing more exotic than what they accuse Christians of. What they say we do is proselytize people. That if you go to a charter school, that there's a bathtub in the lobby that you're forced to dunk in before you go to class and all the rest of it. But to me, this is just proselytization. It's forced thought control. And I either fortunately or unfortunately, Josh, had three daughters that I raised that are brilliant. And they all think like lawyers. Maybe they got that. None of them have pursued the law. But they're I had to buy James Dobson's The Strong-Willed Child book. And it talks about how kids have nothing else to do in their life than to try to beat you as a parent. That's their goal, to find out where that line is with you. And when you say the government gives you a trump card to a child to overcome their parents and to become the parent, I can tell you that strong-willed children are going to choose that. It's a perverse incentive for them to pursue something that they're not even interested in the first place. It's crazy. It's hard for me, if you're listening to this and you hear these ideas and they energize you, I hope they energize you. Folks, it's why Doc Dobson created Family Policy Alliance and focused on the family many years ago, and why we have the state organizations where you live. Please check this out where you live. And we know, folks, as great a leader as Doc Dobson, I worked for Chuck Colson too, was that God uses all of his hands and feet, all of his fingers and his earlobes and his eyeballs out there in the body of Christ. And we want to equip you. That's why we have Josh Hershberger on with us from Indiana Family Institute right now. And he's the author of a book called The Good Citizen. And if you're like me, you get whipped up on a conversation like this and had no idea how to actually sort this out. So I could explain it at a basketball game, my local high school, and my neighbors that are frustrated with what's going on in your culture. Josh, could you tell us why you wrote the book? And I think it's a really good idea. If you're interested in this and you're concerned about it today, you can get a copy. We'll share a link here.
Yeah, thanks, Greg. And as I launch into that, I did want to just say one last thing about the importance of FPA and our state alliance across the country. I think many Christians, you run into something like this, and surely no one should have to choose in between their conscience and their career. And certainly no one should have to choose between their conscience and their child. But these are largely state domestic policy matters, and they're actually very difficult to haul into federal court. And so I can't emphasize enough the work of FPA and the alliance around the country to protect parents in those state domestic policies. So just wanted to really emphasize the work of FPA there. So the book, The Good Citizen, I wrote after a number of years, felt called into the arena of Christian citizenship. And I was at a conference one day, and Tony Perkins, some may know Tony Perkins from Family Research Council, and he just looked at me one day, knew I was a pastor, and said, Josh, where's the church? Where's the church? And the idea is an organization like FPA is on the front lines, defending what the Bible says is true, good, and beautiful. But where is this organization that is the pillar and the ground of the truth, been preaching through the book of Acts? As John Stone Street says, the church is God's plan A. There is no plan B. And so I really internalized that, began to study why, you know, what is the obstacle to getting Christians engaged in public life? And one thing that I discovered is just having a clear biblical understanding of a role as citizen, But then also, where was the kind of practical biblical, listeners may be familiar with Dave Ramsey, this like Dave Ramsey style plan. If you want to engage in your role as citizenship or citizen, what are the baby steps? And so that's what compelled me to write the book. And the four steps simply spell good, as in we are to be good citizens. That's a biblical term. We see it throughout the New Testament. And so just real quickly, here are those steps. And we don't have time to jump into all of that today, but understanding, here are the pieces and how they fit together. And the first one is we should go over our review, our role as citizen according to Scripture. We should be biblical citizens. But then Scripture clearly commands us to offer prayer for, build relationships with our governing officials. You think of the command in 1 Timothy, but also the great work of the prophet Daniel. And if we do that well, our governing officials know we care about them as a person. And then the next step is to offer solutions, partner with government to solve key problems. A key issue that comes up time and time again is something like foster care. And if we do that well, then governing officials know that not only we care about them as a person, we also care about the community. And then finally, that fourth step is to do the hard work of Christian citizenship. So built on a foundation of I know who I am in Christ, I know what my role is, I'm praying for these folks, I'm working in the community to make a difference. And then when it comes to a hard thing, like parental rights, like free speech, like religious liberty, they know that we care, but we're also standing up like Nathan to David and saying, hey, this, you know, taking kids out of a Christian home that's simply raising a kid according to the biological sex, that's way outside of the state's role, and that's not what is best for them. And so hopefully helping Christians kind of put together the different pieces here and say, hey, I'm living out my faith every day, everywhere. So that was the purpose of the book.
Well, I love it, by the way, and I hope you all check out the Good Citizen, folks, because that's really a lot of the questions, and it's a reasonable question, actually. You might think that's a, you know, crazy question, how to be a citizen, until you look back at the remarkable transformation that our culture has gone through over the last 100 years. Yet we used to have radio shows called Days of Our Lives that became TV shows called Days of Our Lives that are now becoming podcasts called Days of Our Lives that the kids think is an invention. You know, all things that were old are becoming new again, and we're consuming these, and people are distracted by that, and they're losing their mooring, and it's happening fast. And you focus on a particular scripture to help keep us grounded in that swirl. And I want to say, I'm going to read it here. Called to be good citizens here, to seek the shalom of our cities and nations. That's the scripture, and it's in multiple books quoted in scripture. And you describe, can you describe how that applies today? It's not just we're seeking to be good citizens, but why we're talking about this so what, when we're policy organizations, is God says that's the key to the city, too, the shalom in the city. Tell us about that.
Absolutely. And so just going straight back to the Great Commission, where Jesus, he first says, and this is an important part that sometimes we pull out of it. He says, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth, in Matthew chapter number 28, meaning Jesus is king, right? So because Jesus is king, he says, go, therefore, teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe, here it is, all things whatsoever I have commanded you. Lo, I'm with you always, even unto the end of the world. And so if I were to kind of grind down the Great Commission into a couple things, it is Jesus essentially is saying, go tell everyone, everywhere, everything I have commanded you. And so the command to the church was not to just go make converts, not to just tell people about the good news of eternal salvation, but to make disciples, people who wholly follow the whole way of Jesus. And then the Apostle Paul follows this up in Philippians chapter number 1 and verse 27. And it's interesting because he himself had Roman civitas. He's speaking to some Greek Christians under Roman rule. And he says, only let your conversation, the Greek word there is polituomai. You can probably hear that root, politics. Only let your politics or your citizenship be as it becomes the gospel of Christ. That whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs. So Paul literally said, let your citizenship be worthy of the gospel. And then as we see this early movement of Christ's followers go out and impact the Roman Empire, they were advocating against abortion. They were standing up for the equal dignity of slaves and of those in the gladiatorial games. And then historians and church fathers tell us that wherever there was an opportunity to be engaged in the civic life of their cities. That's where Christians were. And then in a little bit over three centuries, they literally transformed the Roman Empire. And so I source, Christ tells us to be disciples. Disciples just so happen to be good citizens. And as I look 20, 30 years down the road, if our churches are strong and they're making disciples that go out and impact their zip code, that's how we transform our city, state, and nation, the power of the gospel.
Well, now, okay, Josh, that's a big ask, but it comes from a guy who has all the resources we need when he says, Jesus says, boil the oceans on earth.
Yes.
He does. And he has the power to boil the oceans if he chooses to. I'm giving a metaphor for you at home. It would be very hard for a human being to boil the ocean, to get disciples all over earth and change everywhere on earth and have everyone on earth understand everything that Jesus said. But that is his command. And so we have to break the ocean down into little pots of water that we can boil in our own Christian walk with Jesus. And we are blessed to have organizations. If you're like me and my wife, Stacy, we try to serve the Lord. We try to do that Great Commission. And I remember it as a prison fellowship. And I'd be, how do I visit the prisoner? And we try to make that easy for people. And that's what we do at Family Policy. It's at Indiana Family Institute. You guys break this down, and where people are overwhelmed and they're confused, but they know that the Spirit, when they're listening to me talk right now, the Spirit has been telling you this. I can hear the Spirit affirming this with me right now. The Spirit's been telling you this for several years, not just the last two or three, that it's time for you to listen to this podcast, get off the couch and raise your hand and say, how can I help? Whether you have a half an hour, a month, or 3 hours a week, get started. How do they get started at Indiana Family Institute? And for those of you that are listening around the country, I want you to know that there are 40 state organizations, and the answer is self-evident. If you're in one of the 10 states we don't have a family policy organization, we want you to raise your hand and let us know who you are while we're building one there. But they employ over 400 employees, have more than $60 million of infrastructure, and work with 50,000 churches on a weekly basis, not around politics, you know, around elections every 4 years, but on the hands and feet of Jesus in the community where you live. So tell folks how they can get involved with Indiana Family Institute, as well as you and I'll speculate, and we'll put up links for how they find the other family policy councils in their own state.
Well, I appreciate what you said there, Craig, because there are days, I can only imagine at the national level as well, of, wow, this is a lot. How in the world do we do all this? But I truly believe that most Christians are going to have their greatest impact in their own zip code. In fact, God calls his church, in a sense, the local church, to the cities, right? And so really, how do we equip Christians to do that? So we've recently been talking through our kind of mission statement, and we updated it to say this: the Indiana Family Institute disciples Christians to impact Indiana so the gospel advances, families thrive, religious liberty flourishes, and life is protected. And we accomplish that through a comprehensive strategy, but that really is the goal. How do we equip the individual Christian, the church leader, to go out and make a difference? And so one of the key things we're doing is our church ambassador network. And God has truly, all I can say is God's just given us favor there with our governor, with all three branches of government. Just this year, we had over 1,200 connections between pastors and governing officials, praying with folks, building relationships with folks, regardless of what's behind their name. And that has led to some amazing partnerships. We see these two God-ordained institutions, government and the church. We think that they actually are supposed to design, they're designed to work together in the way that God designed it. And so one issue has been addiction recovery. Clearly, the state legislature can't legislate hope. It can't pay for purpose. That's what the church does. And so we realize in our state that we have some amazing addiction recovery ministries. I'm sure, Craig, in your work for Prison Fellowship, you met many of these incredible ministries. One of them has a 98% success rate. If folks go through their program, they don't go back to drugs. They don't go back to jail. But we realized a lot of them were not talking to one another. And so in October, we've participated in the inaugural Faith and Recovery Conference here in Indiana. We're going to try to bring everybody together and collaborate in a better way. And it's been so neat to see that our Chief Justice of the Indiana Supreme Court was interested, and she's actually going to come and keynote that particular conference. So that's that partnership piece. And then Ryan McCann, our executive director, our policy team, counted up that over about the last 5 to 6 years, we've had over 30 policy wins. So 30 laws to support what is good, true, and beautiful. A couple of those are our big FPA initiatives, protecting women's sports, minors not taking hormones or having life-altering surgeries. And then one that we're really proud of is we passed age verification for all pornographic websites. So if an individual wants to log on to a place like Pornhub, they got to put in their driver's license. And due to a Seventh Circuit decision, I'm happy to tell you today, Pornhub is shut down in Indiana. And so those are just a couple of examples, and similar work is being done by all of the FPA affiliates, the family policy councils around the country. And so I tell you, I'm just so excited to be a part of this and see what God's doing.
Well, Josh, it's been exciting to work with you. We're going to put the links up for The Good Citizen. I assume it's available on Amazon and bookstores, Barnes & Noble, Christian bookstores for sure. If you don't want to give your money to Amazon, that's what Stacy and I do. We prefer to go to Christian books and other retailers, right?
You know, also over at justgoodcitizen.us is there. And we recently launched something I'm really excited about is we recently launched a Bible study version of this because pastors told me, hey, where's the best place for this to get worked out is in that small group or Sunday school. We have some companion videos. I had a chance to stop at a church about 2 weeks ago as the pastor led his own congregation through this material. And so just it's not anything that I've done, but just seeing the scriptures being taught, people being encouraged to be a good citizen.
Well, folks, we want to bring you the best resources in the world. That's why we produce this show, and that's why we invite in people like Dr. Jack Myers and the Colson Center on Stone Street, my old colleague from Prison Fellowship there, and Josh Hershberger. And they've been invited to check his book out, and now the release of the Small Group Study Guide. And you heard from him how exciting and transformative it is for you to be involved locally. And that's a differentiation point. When you get involved with family policy councils and family policy alliance, we bring our solutions from the kitchen table toward our city councils and our school boards up to the White House instead of the other way around. And you'll be participating in that. We encourage you to, if you're not already following the Indiana Family Institute or Family Policy Alliance, that you click it here. Join us, stay tuned, and check out The Good Citizen. Thanks again for being with us, Josh.
Oh, thanks so much for the opportunity. Thanks, Greg.
Yeah.